टुडे प्रोफेसर डॉक्टर मनोज कुमार विल गिव लेक्चर ऑन द सेकेंड पार्ट ऑफ द आइजैक न्यूटन. इन द लास्ट लेक्चर वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द अर्ली लाइफ ऑफ द आइजैक न्यूटन, मिडिल ईयर्स ऑफ द आइजैक न्यूटन, डेवलपमेंट ऑफ हिज वर्क इन द मैथमेटिक्स, development of the his work in the optics, and the development of the his work in the mechanics and gravitation. And today we continue for the lecture of the Isaac Newton. Isaac Newton was the great personality of the world, and every people must learn about the Isaac Newton. Newton's postulate of an invisible force able to act over vast distances led to him being criticized for the introducing occult agency into science. Later, in the second edition of the Principia, Newton firmly rejected such criticism in a concluding general solium, writing that it was enough that the phenomena implied a gravitational attraction, as they did, but they did not so far indicate its cause, and it was both unnecessary and improper to frame the hypothesis of the things that were not implied by the phenomena. Newton used what became his famous expression, hypothesis non fingo. With the Principia, Newton became internationally recognized. With the book of the Principia, Newton became internationally recognized. He acquired a circle of the admirers, including the Swiss-born mathematician Nicolas Fatty Dulelier. Classification of the cubes. In 1710, Newton found 72 of the 78 species of the cubic curves and categorized them into the four types in 1707, and probably with the Newton's help, James Stirling proved that every cubic was one of these four types. Newton also claimed that the four types could be obtained by the plane projection from one of them, and this was proved in the 1739, 4 years after his death. Later life. In the 1690, Newton wrote a number of the religious tracts dealing with the literal and the symbolic interpretation of the Bible. A manuscript Newton sent to the John Locke, in which he disputed the fallacy of the John 5-7, the Johnny Comma, and his fidelity to the original manuscript of the New Testament remained unpublished until 1785. Newton was also a member of the Parliament of the England for the Cambridge University in 1689 and 1701. But according to some accounts, his only comments were to complain about a cold draught in the chamber and request that the window be closed. He was, however, noted by the Cambridge diarist Abraham D. Lepire to have rebuked students who were fighting local by claiming that a house was haunted. Newton moved to the London to take up the post of the warden of the Royal Mint in 1696, a position that he had obtained through the patronage of the Charles Montagu, first Earl of the Halifax, then Chancellor of the Exchequer. He took charge of the England's great reckoning, trod on the toes of the Lord Lucas, Governor of the Tower, and secured the job of the Deputy Comptroller of the temporary Chester branch of the Edmund Hillary. Newton became perhaps the best known master of the mint upon the death of the Thomas Neale in 1699. A position Newton held for the last 3 years was of his life. These appointments were intended as the sincere, but Newton took them seriously. He retired from his Cambridge duty in 1701. And exercise his authority to reform the currency and punish clippers and the counter fighters. As warden and afterwards is master of the Royal Mint, Newton estimated that the 20% of the coins taken in during the great reconnaissance of the 1696 was the counterfeit. Counterfeiting was the high treason punishable by felon being hanged, drawn, and quartered. Despite this convincing, even the most pregnant criminals could be extremely difficult. However, Newton proved equal to the task. Discussed as a habitue of the bars and the taverns, he gathered much of that evidence himself. For all the various plates to the prosecution and separating the branches of the government, English law still had ancient and the formidable custom of the authority. Newton had himself made a justice of the peace in all the home country. A draft letter regarding the matter is included in the Newton's personal first edition in the Philosophio Nostris Principia Mathematics, which he must have been amending at the time. Then he conducted more than 100 cross-examination of witnesses, informers, and suspects between the June 1698 and the Christmas 1690. Newton successfully prosecuted 28 coiners. Newton was made president of the Royal Society in 1703 and an associate of the French Academie des Sciences. In his position at the Royal Society, Newton made an enemy of the John Flamsteed, the astronomer lawyer, by prematurely publishing Flamsteed's Historia Crustacea Britannica, which Newton had used in his duty. In April 1705, Kuhn knighted Newton during a royal visit to the Trinity College, Cambridge. The knighthood is likely to have been motivated by the political consideration connected with the parliament election in May 1705, rather than any recognition of the Newton's scientific work or services as the master of the mint. Newton was the second scientist to be the knighted after the Francis Bacon. As a result of the report written by the Newton on 21 September 1717 to the Lords Commissioner of His Majesty Treasury, the bimetallic relationship between the gold coin and silver coin was changed by the Royal Proclamation on the 27 December 1717, forbidding the exchange of the gold guineas for more than 21 silver shillings. This eventually resulted in a silver shortage, as silver coins were used to pay for imports while exports were paid for in gold, effectively moving Britain from the silver standard to its first gold standard. It is a matter of debate as to whether he intended to do this or not. It has been argued that the Newton conceived of his work at the mint as a continuation of his Acmel work. Newton was invested in the South Sea Company and lost some $20,000 pound, $4 million in 2001 when it collapsed in around 1772. Newton was invested in the South Sea Company. South Sea Company mein unhone paise invest kiye and lost or ho diya $20,000. And 4 million in 2020 when it collapsed in around 1720. Ye aapko collapse kar gaya 1720 mein. Towards the end of his life, Newton took up residence at the Cranberry Park near Winchester with his niece and husband until his death in 1726. His half niece, Katharina Barton Condit, served as his hostess in the social affair at his house on the Jermyn Street in London. He was her very loving uncle, according to his letter to her when she was recovering from smallpox. Personal relations of the Newton. Although it was claimed that he was once engaged, Newton never married. The French writer and the philosopher Voltaire, who was in London at the time of the Newton's funeral, said that he was never sensible to any passion, was not subject to the common frailty of the mankind, nor had any commerce with women, a circumstance which is assured me by the physician and surgeon who attended him in his last moment. This now widespread belief that he died a virgin has been commented on the writers as diverse of the mathematician Charles Hutton, economist John Marion Keynes, and the physicist Carl Sagan. Newton had a close relationship with the Swiss mathematician Nicolas Fortier de Moulier, whom he met in the London around. Some of their correspondence was survived. Their relationship came to an abrupt and unexplained end in 1693, and at the same time, Newton suffered a nervous breakdown, which included sending wild a courtesy letter to his friend Samuel Pepys and the John Locke. His note to the letter included the charge and the Locke indigravate to the me for the omen. In 2015, Stephen Weinberg, a Nobel laureate in physics, called Newton a nasty antagonist and a bad man to have an enemy. He particularly noted Newton's attitude towards Robert Hooke and Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz. Death. Newton died in his sleep in London on March 20, 1727, NS 30, March 1727. His body was buried in Westminster Abbey. Voltaire may have been present at this funeral. A bachelor, he divested much of his estate to the relative during his last year and died instead. His paper went to the John Condit and Catherine of Winter. After his death, Newton's hair was examined and found to contain mercury, probably resulting from his archangel pursuits. Mercury poisoning could explain Newton's eccentricity in late life. After death, fame. The mathematician Joseph Louis Langevin said that the Newton was the greatest genius who ever lived, and once added that the Newton was also the most fortunate, for we cannot find more than one system of the world to establish. English poet Alexander Pope wrote the famous epitaph, "Nature and nature's law laid him in the night. God said, let Newton be, and all was the right." Newton was relatively modest about his achievement, writing in a letter to the Robert Hooke in the February 1776, starting, "If I win further, it is by standing on the shoulders of the giants." Two writers think that the above quotation, written at a time when the Newton and Hooke were in dispute over optical discovery, was an oblique attack on the Hooke, rather than on in addition to a statement of the modesty. On the other hand, the widely known probe about the standing on the shoulders of the giant, published among others by the 17th century poet George Herbert, a former orator of the University of Cambridge and fellow of the Trinity College, in his Jacques Pradin, had an its main point, a dwarf on a giant's shoulder, sees father of the two. And so it's a fact, and an analogy would place Newton himself rather than Hooke as a dwarf. In a later memoir, Newton wrote, "I don't know what I may appear to the world, but to myself I seem to have been only like a boy playing on the seashore and diverting myself in now and then finding a smoother pebble or a prettier sail than ordinary, while as the great ocean of the truth lay undiscovered before me." In 1816, a tooth said to have belonged to the Newton was sold for the 730 in London to an aristocrat who had it set in a ring. Guinness World Record 2002 classified it as the most valuable tooth, which would for approximately $25 in late 2001. Who bought it and who currently has it to be not to be disclosed. Albert Einstein kept a picture of the Newton on his study wall alongside one of the Michael Faraday and the James Clerk Maxwell. In a 2005 survey of members of the Britain's Royal Society, formerly headed by the Newton, asking who had the greater effect on the history of the science, Newton or Einstein, the members deemed Newton to have made the greater overall contribution. In 1919, an opinion poll of the 100 of the days leading to the physics voted Einstein the greatest physicist ever, with the Newton's run-up, while a parallel survey, the rank and file physicist by the physicist wave, gave the top spot of the Newton. The highest derived unit of the force is named Newton in his honor. The SI derived unit of the force is named Newton in his honor. Newton's monument 731 can be seen in the Westminster Abbey at the north of the stairs to the choir against the choir skin near his tomb. It was executed by the sculptor Michael Rasberg in 1694-1770 in white and the great marble with design by the architect William Kent. The monument features a figure of the Newton reclining on top of a scrogover, his right elbow resting on several of his great books and his left hand pointing to a scroll with a mathematical design. Above him is a pyramid and a celestial globe showing the signs of the zodiac and the path of the comet of the 1680. A relief panel depicts putting using instruments such as the telescope and the prism. The Latin inscription of the base translates as, "Here is buried Isaac Newton, knight, who by a strength of the mind almost divine and mathematical principle peculiarly his own explored the course and figures of the planets and the paths of the comets and tide of the sea. The dissimilarity in the rays of the light and what now the color was previously imagined, the property of the colors thus produced, diligent sages and the faithful in his exposition of nature, antiquity, and the holy scripture, he vindicated by his philosophy and majesty of the God might and good, and expressed the simplicity of the gospel in his manner. The mortals rejoiced that there was existed such and so great an ornament of the human race. He was born on the 25 December 1642 and died on the 20 March 67. Translation from G.L. Smith, The Monuments and the Genie of the St. Paul Cathedral and of the Westminster Abbey in 703 and the 704. From 1978 until 1988, an image of the Newton designed by the Harry Ecclestone appeared on the series of the D-1 bank mart issued by the Bank of the England. The last one note to be issued by the Bank of England. Newton was shown on the reserve of the notes holding a book and accompanied by the telescope, a prism and map of the solar system. This is the recognition given to the Newton. बैंक नोट पर भी बैंक ऑफ इंग्लैंड ने न्यूटन का जो है इमेज डिजाइन किया. न्यूटन वॉज शोन एज द रिवर्स ऑफ द नोट होल्डिंग ए बुक. ए स्टेच्यू ऑफ द आइजैक न्यूटन लुकिंग एट एन एप्पल एट हिज फीट कैन बी सीन एट द ऑक्सफोर्ड यूनिवर्सिटी म्यूजियम ऑफ द नेचुरल हिस्ट्री. ए लार्ज ब्रांच स्टेच्यू न्यूटन आफ्टर द विलियम ब्लैक by the Adorno Poenji, dated 1995 and inspired by the black stitching, dominates the pizza of the British Library in the London. Blacks dominates the pizza of the British Library in London. Religious view. Although born into the Angusian family by his 30, Newton held a Christian faith that had been made public, would not have been considered orthodox by the mainstream Christianity, with one historian leveling with a hectic. In 1672, he had started to record his geological researches in the notebooks, which he showed to no one and which have only recently been examined. They demonstrate an extensive knowledge of the earlier churches, writing, and show that in the conflict between the Athenians and the Orcus, which defined the creed, he took the side of the Arius, the lodger who rejected the conventional view of the Trinity. Newton recognized just as a divine mediator between the God and man, who was subordinate to the Father who created him. He was especially interested in the prophecy, but for him, the great apostasy was the Trinitarian. Newton tried unsuccessfully to obtain one of the two fellowships that exempted the holder from the ordination requirement. At the last moment in 1675, he received a dispensation from the government that excluded him all future holder of the Lusken chair. In Newton's eye, worshipping just as good was the idolatry, to him the fundamental sin. In 1919, historian Stephen wrote Isaac Newton was a heretic, but he never made a public declaration of his private faith, which the Orthodox would have deemed extremely radical. He did his faith so well that the scholars are still unraveling his personal belief. Snowden concludes that the Newton was at least a Socinian sempiter, possibly an Arian, and almost certainly an anti-Tertian. In a minority position, T.C. Pichmayer offers a more nuanced view, arguing that the Newton held closer to the semi-Arian view of the Trinity, that Jesus Christ was the similar substance homogeneous from the Father rather than the Orthodox view that the Jesus Christ is one of the same substance of the Father as the endorsed by the modern Eastern Orthodox. Roman Catholics and the Protestant, however, this type of the view has lost support of the late with the ability of the Newton's theological paper. And now most scholars identify Newton as an anthematician monothesis. Although the law of the motion and universal gravitation become the Newton's best known discovery, she warned against using them to view the universe as a mere machine, as Aquin of the Great Cock. He said, so then gravity may put the planets into motion, but without the divine power, it could not never put them into a such circulating motion as they have about the sun. Along with his scientific fang, Newton's study of the Bible and of the early church fathers were also noteworthy. Newton wrote works on the textual criticism, most notably an historical account of the two notable corruption of the scripture, and observation upon the prophets of the Daniel and the apocalypse of the son John. He placed the crucifixion of the Jesus Christ at the 3 April AD 23, which agrees with one traditionally accepted date. He believed in a rationally immanent world, but he rejected the Hermesian impact in the language and the branch Sophonia. The order dramatically inferred universe could be understood and must be understood by an active reason. In his correspondence, Newton claimed that in writing the Principia, I had an eye upon such principles as might work with the consulting man for the belief of the deity. He saw the evidence of the design in the system of the world. Such a wonderful uniformity in the planetary system must be allowed the effect of the choice. But Newton stated that divine intervention would eventually be required to reform the system. Due to the slow growth of the instability for this lamish, lampwood him, good elementary wants to wind up his watch from time to time, otherwise it could cease to the move. He had not, it seems, sufficient foresight to make it perpetual motion. Newton's position was vigorously defended by his fellow Samuel Clarke in a famous correspondence. A century later, Prime Simon Laplace's work, Celestial Mechanics, had a natural explanation for why the planet orbits don't require periodic divine intervention. The contrast between the Laplace mechanistic worldview and the Newton's one is the most stand considering the famous answer which the French scientist gave Napoleon, who had criticized him for the absence of the creator in the Macfrey-Cleste. Sir J. Poume, Passer dissenter, I don't need such a hypothesis. Scholars long debated whether Newton disputed the doctrine of the Trinity. His first biographer, David Brewster, who compiled his manuscript, interpreted Newton as a questioning the veracity of the some passage used to support the Trinity, but never denying the doctrine of the Trinity as much. In the 20th century, encrypted manuscript written by the Newton and bought by the John Mary Carnegie were deciphered, and it became known that the Newton did indeed reject Trinitarianism. Effect on the religious thought. Newton and Robert Boyle's approach to the mechanical philosophy was promoted by the rationalist painter as a viable alternative to the pantry and the intolerance, and was accepted hemistically by the Orthodox preacher as well as distinct preacher like the Latitudinian. The clarity and simplicity of the science was seen as a way of the combat the emotional and metaphysical superlatives of the both superstitious enthusiasm and threat of the atheism. And at the same time, the second wave of the English deists used Newton's discovery to demonstrate the philosophy of a natural religion. The attacks made against Pre enlightenment magical thinking and the mystical elements of the Christianity were given their foundation with the Boyle's mechanical conception of the universe. Newton's gave Boyle's idea their completion through the mathematical proofs, and perhaps more importantly, was very successful in popularizing them. Occult, in a manuscript we wrote in 704, never intended to be published. He mentions the date of the 1260, but it is not given as a date for the end of the day. He has been falsely reported as a prediction. The passage is clear when the date is read in context. He was against date setting for the end of the day, concerned that he would put Christianity into the disrepute. So then the times half a time are the 42 months or the 1260 days or 3 years and a half record. According 12 months to year and 30 days to month was done in the calendar of the primitive year, and the days of the short-lived beast being put for the years of the long-lived kingdom, the period of the 1260 days. If dated from the complete conquest of the three kings, AC 800 will end 2060. It may end later, but I see no reason for ending sooner. This I mention not to assert when the time of the end shall be, but to put a stop to the rash conjecture of the facial men who are frequently predicting the time of the end, and by doing so, being the scat frosty into the discreet edge of their prestigious fail, just comes as a thief in the night, and it is not us for know the times and season which God hath put into his one breast. Alchemy, in the character of the Morton Opry, poor Superman, spelt to fiction author Fitz Layer, says Newton. Everyone knows Newton as a great scientist. Few may remember that he spent half his life mudding his archy looking for the philosopher's stone. That was the pebble by the seashore he really wanted to find. Of an estimated 10 million words of the writing of the Newton's paper, about 1 million deal with the alchemy. Many of Newton's writing on alchemy were are copies of the other manuscript with his one emanation. Alchemical text mixed Australian knowledge with the philosophical equation of hidden behind layers of the wordplay. Algae and the impagy to protect craft secret. Some of the content in Newton's paper could have been considered heretical by the church. In 1808, after spending 16 years cataloging Newton's paper, Cambridge University kept a small number of and returned the rest of the Earl of the postmark. In 1936, a descent offered the papers for the sale of the Stonebody. The collection was broken up and sold for a total of the about £9,000. John Madden Key was one of the about three dozen bidders who obtained part of the collection at auction. Kenneth went on to the resemble and estimated half of Newton's collection of the paper on alchemy before donating his collection to the Cambridge University in the 1946. All of Newton's now writing on alchemy are currently being put online in a project undertaken by the Indiana University. The Christianity of the Isaac Newton and summarized in a book. Newton's fundamental contribution to the science include the qualification of the gravitational attraction and discovery that white light is actually a mixture of the inverse spectral color and the formulation of the calculus. Yet there is another more mysterious side to Newton that is imperfectly known, a realm of the activity that spawned some 30 years of his life, although he kept it largely hidden from his contemporary and the colleagues. We refer to the Newton's involvement in the discipline of the alchemy, or which was often called 17th century England chemistry. Charles Constant glimpsed dispute that the Newton ever practiced alchemy, said his chemistry was in the spirit of the Boyle's conspiracy philosophy. In June 20, two unpublished pages of the Newton's known and John Baptist Harmot book on the plague display were excellent online Brahmas Newton's analysis of this book, which may made Cambridge while protecting himself from London 65 to 67 infection, is the most substantial written statement he is known to have made about the plague. According to Brahmi, as far as the therapy is concerned, Newton writes that the beast is a toad suspended by the legs in a chimney for the 3 days. which at last vomited up earth and various insect in it on a dish of the yellow wax, and shortly after that, combining the powder toad with the exertion and serum made into the lozenges and worn about the affected area, drove away the contagion and drew out the poison. Enlightenment philosopher closes short history of the scientific physician Galileo Boyle and Newton principally as the guides granter of their application of their singular concept of the nature and the natural law to the every physical and social field of the day. In this respect, the lesson of the history and the social structure built up, it could be discarded. It was Newton's conception of the universe based upon natural and rationally understandable law that become one of the seeds for the Enlightenment ideology. Locke and Voltaire applied concept of the natural law to the political system, advocating intrinsic rights. The physiocrats and Adam Smith applied natural conception of the psychology and self-interest to the economic system, and socialists criticized the current social order for trying to fit history into the natural models of the progress. Monboddo and Samuel Clarke resisted elements of the Newton's work, but eventually rationalized it to conform with their strong religious view of the nature. Apple accident. Newton himself often told the story that he was inspired to formulate his theory of the gravitation by watching the fall of an apple from a tree. The story is believed to have passed into the popular knowledge after being narrated by the Catherine Burton, Newton's naissance to the Voltaire. Voltaire then wrote in his essay on the epic poetry, Sir Isaac Newton, walking in his garden, had the first thought of the his system of the gravitation upon seeing and the apple falling from a tree. Although it has been said that the apple story is a myth and that did not arrive at his theory of the gravity at any single moment. A contest of the Newton, whose manuscript account for the 1752 has been made available by the Royal Society, do in fact confirm the incident. Though not the apocryphal version that the apple actually hit Newton's head, secretly recorded in his Memoirs of the Sir Isaac Newton's Life, a conversation with the Newton in the Kingston on the April 15, 1726. We went into the garden and drank under the shade of the some apatacy, only himself amidst for the discourse, he told me. He was just in the same situation as when formerly the notion of the gravitation came into his mind. Why should that apple always descend perpendicularly to the ground? This was the question. Why should that apple always descend perpendicular to the ground? Thought he to himself, occurred by the fall of an apple, as he said in the contemporary mood, why should it not go sideways or upward, but constantly to the earth's center? Assuredly, the reason is that the earth draws it. There must be a drawing power in matter, and the sum of the drawing power in the matter of the earth must be in the earth's center, not in any side of the earth. Therefore, docks with the apple fall perpendicularly or toward the center. If matter that the draws matter, it must be in proportion of the its quantity. Therefore, the apple draws the earth as well as the earth draws the apple. These are the figure of the Newton's figure of the apple. Reputed descent of the Newton's apple tree from top to bottom at the Trinity College, Cambridge, the Cambridge University Botanic Garden, and the Institution Barcelo Library Garden in the Argentina. Newton's tree, apple tree, has been shown here in the Trinity College, London. Newton's apple tree at the Trinity College, Cambridge, the Cambridge University Botanic Garden, and the Instituto Barcelo Library Garden in the Argentina. John Condit Newton assignment assistant at the Royal Mint and the husband of the Newton. Nisse also described the event when he wrote about the Newton's life. In the year 1666, he retired again from the Cambry to his mother in the Lincolnshire. Whilst he was peaceably meaning in a garden, it came into his thought that the power of the gravity which brought an apple from a tree to the ground was not limited to a certain distance from the earth, but that this power must extend much further than was the usually thought. Why not as high as the moon, said to himself, if so, that must influence her motion, perhaps retain her in her orbit. Whereupon he fell a calculating that would be the effect of that supposition. It is known from his notebook that the Newton was grappling in the late 16th with the idea that the terrestrial gravity extends in an inverse square proportion to the moon. However, it took him decades to develop the full-fledged theory. The question was not whether gravity existed, but whether it is extended so far from Earth, and it could also be the force holding the moon to its orbit. Newton showed that if the force decreased as the inverse square of the distance, one could indeed calculate the moon's orbital period and get good agreement. He guessed the same force was responsible for other orbital motion, hence named it universal gravitation. How the universal gravitation has been named has been described here. Various trees are claimed to be the apple tree with the Newton described. The King's School, Gartham, claims that the tree was purchased by the school, unrooted and transported to the headmaster's garden some years later. The staff of the now National Trust won ultra minor dispute this and claim that a tree present in their garden is the one described by the Newton. A descent of the original tree can be seen growing outside the main gate of the Trinity College, Cambridge, below the room Newton lived in and when he studied there. The National Fruit Collection at the Borgate in Kent can supply grafts from their tree, which appears identical to the flower of Kent, a coarse-fleshed cooking variety. These are the works of the Newton published in his lifetime. De analysis per acquisition numero termination infant published there. Of natura obvious laws processor in vegetation. De montu comprum in gerum. Philosophy nostri principia mathematics. Skull gadium colri, colri description sinum. Optics report as master of the me. Arithmetica University. Published posthumously. De mundi systeme optical lectures. The chronology of the ancient kingdom amended. Observation on Daniel and the Aquarius of the St. John, method of the Fluxion, a historical account of the two notable corruption of the scripture. These are the published posthumously. Primary sources, Newton Isaac, the Principia Mathematical University of the California Press. Newton Isaac, the optical paper, Isaac Newton, the optical lecture, Newton Isaac, online edition of the Atwood. Florin Cagill, was D.D. Ashton. These are the
Thank you.